Medical experts say that this is the worst E. coli epidemic in history. Hundreds of people poisoned, children dying. People are outraged and afraid that it has all come from something that is almost innocuous. It is a staple of the American diet, hamburger. Virtually everyone who has been poisoned ate hamburger at an area Jack-in-the-Box, hamburger contaminated with the E. coli bacteria. Tonight we're going to talk about how this could happen, how giving your child a bite of hamburger from a restaurant or from your home risks their life and their health. Over the next hour, we are going to hear from victims and from medical experts, from a state health inspector who says there's not enough of him to go around, from Jack-in-the-Box employees, I believe, who may be here, who say they're being harassed by people who are calling them baby killers. First, though, I want you to meet Steve Cockerham, a federal meat inspector who is putting his job on the line to talk with us tonight, talk candidly about what the U.S. Department of Agriculture would much rather keep secret. By the way, his boss, the U.S. Secretary of Agriculture, is going to be in our area Tuesday testifying down in Olympia on this very subject, on the epidemic. Steve, let me ask you something here. The E. coli bacteria comes from the intestines of warm-blooded animals, obviously cattle. What have you seen when you inspect the slaughterhouses? How does that get into something like hamburger?
Well, what basically happens is the manure, the feces, gets onto the carcass, and then it gets into the hamburger by not being trimmed off, and then it goes into the hamburger trimmings from the carcass, or it gets into the carcass head meat, which they take and process right away. They take the cheeks and stuff off of the head, put it into 60-pound boxes, which are frozen right away, and then they ship those 60-pound frozen boxes of head meat off to processors who don't look at it again. They throw the frozen 60-pound block of meat onto a bandsaw to saw it up into sticks or a flaker or chipper. And then they flake it or chip it or saw it up and put it in directly into the grinder, and it goes into the hamburger that way.
Okay, so just so that we understand where we're going here, then the blades that are used to cut it up, the grinder that is used to grind it up, they also become contaminated with this, so that everything and anything else that then comes in contact with that is also contaminated.
If that was contaminated meat running through there, yes, that would happen.
Let's back up for a moment, though. How specifically does the feces from the intestines get into the meat? I mean, what is it, an accident? It's certainly not done deliberately.
Well, the feces, you have animals that are coated with fecal matter when they come in from the yards on their hides, and it gets on there during the dehide process. Or if the eviscerators break a paunch or a gut when they eviscerate the animal, it could get on there that way. And under the past few years, under the streamlined inspection system, meat inspectors weren't allowed to check for contamination. We were told that was the company's responsibility. So therefore, and I'd caught them several times, not trimming contamination, not trimming pathology, open abscess and such off of beef. I shut down the line one time and got into it hot and heavy with a foreman over not properly trimming a carcass.
So let's make this clear. You're trying to maintain a degree of health standards and getting in an argument with the people who are giving us the meat. The slaughterhouse
foreman, they're under pressure. It all goes down to line speed. And the problem is you have three major packers that have a 90% share of the market. For all practical purposes, IBP, XL, and ConAgra-Montfort supply the meat for the United States that we eat. They're politically powerful. All they have to do is make a phone call to our hierarchy in Washington, and we get told to back off.
So if you make too much noise, the next thing you know, you're on the phone hearing a voice going, Steve, you're slowing stuff down. You're creating a problem. What's the issue here? You're being criticized?
Yeah.
I'm trying to understand, you know, when you say the fecal material is on the cows from the yards and everything, this is not something that can be hosed off.
No, if you wash fecal, well, first of all, USDA regulations under traditional inspection do not allow washing of fecal contamination. That has to be trimmed off. If you were to wash it, you would wash off maybe some of the surface stuff, but you would wash a lot into the beef.
Well, then let me ask what might seem to be an overly obvious question. Why don't they trim it?
Well, because of the line speeds. Line speeds are running in excess in the cyst plants, and in some traditional plants are running in excess of 300 head per hour. At that speed, the line runs at my plant, where I'm assigned, the line runs at 41 feet per minute. An inspector on the final trim station responsible for cleaning up that carcass has 6 seconds to adjust the carcass, do the required palpations, palpating the internal inguinal and lymph node, palpating the kidney, palpating the diaphragm, the skirt, and then probably about 2 or 3 seconds left to look over an 8-foot carcass for contamination.
What is it that you're looking for?
Any kind of contamination, fecal contamination, pathological contamination, such as abscess or arthritis fluid or mastitis fluid, oil, grease, hair, dirt, scurf, just any contaminant that would be on that beef.
So give me, just from your best educated guess, how much of this stuff goes through without getting caught? How much contaminated meat?
It's hard to give you
a lot,
an accurate
a little
estimate. I'll tell you, a lot gets through, yes, because of the simple fact of the line speeds and the outdated mode in which we're doing the rail inspection or the final trim.
And USDA does not check for E. coli, does it?
No, not to my knowledge, they don't.
How often do you shut the line down for this fecal matter on cows? Does it ever happen? Does it ever come about that you just shut it down and say, hey, you guys are doing it wrong, or they got a new guy on there that's blowing it, or?
We've shut, I can speak from the plant I work at, we shut the line down quite often, as a matter of fact, and make sure they get the trimming done as best as we can get it done. The trouble is, we don't have the authority as inspectors to go to company management and say, hey, you're getting too much contamination on this beef from whatever process, whether it's dehide, whether it's evisceration. You're getting too much contamination on the beef, you need to slow your line speed down. We don't have that authority as
who does?
The supervisor in the plant would have that authority.
Is it ever exercised?
I've not seen it exercised very often, no. Some, yes, but not very often.
Steve, what position is the carcass in when the hide is taken off? I used to work in a slaughterhouse when I was a kid, and I'm just wondering, we never had any problem like that. I'm wondering how they're doing it different now.
You probably did a bed dress operation or something like that in a smaller slaughterhouse where the carcass was on the floor, and you dehided the carcass and then lifted it up and dehided as the carcass went up. Now they do it all with on the line. The carcasses are the beef are knocked in the head, and their throats are slit, and they're bled, and then they're hung immediately from on a rail, and then a moving chain takes it with fingers, you know, grabs the trolley and takes the carcass on around. They have side pullers now, and they'll make the initial cuts to get the carcass opened up.
Is this better or worse than the way it used to be done, in your estimation?
In my estimation, if we had the proper safeguards in place, it could be better.
How much of an impact? It was in 1986, Congress deregulated the meat industry and began to have the USDA, streamlined inspection.
Streamlined inspection.
How much of an impact has that had on the level of contaminated meat we receive?
In my opinion, it's had a lot of impact because basically what we're seeing with the USDA, they're eventually and gradually deregulating the meat industry, taking inspectors out of positions where they can see this contamination and get it removed.
What position, if any, does President Clinton hold? I mean, can he get better inspectors in or more inspectors?
To my knowledge, the president hasn't addressed the meat safety issue as of yet. Hopefully, with the change in administration, we can be able to get more things done, food safety-wise.
You know, several times over the past few years, the National Academy of Sciences has gone to the USDA and has said, you need to be conducting bacterial examinations of the meat that's going through here, and the USDA keeps going, no problem. In effect, the USDA, and correct me if I'm wrong, says, look, consumer, assume that the meat you're buying and the meat you're eating is toxic, cook it accordingly, and from there, we're not saying much else. Correct or not?
I testified before the National Academy of Sciences on two different occasions. What they said in their final report was that streamlined inspection, as it were, didn't produce a better quality of beef, and in some cases produced an inferior quality to the regular traditional inspection. Now, from that, the USDA took their report, pulled out some glorified parts of it, and blew it up, as you will, into a big recommendation by the National Academy for Streamlined Inspection. They ignored the recommendations for bacterial inspections or examinations. They say that the technology right now is not available for a practical bacteria.
And we'll get into that in a moment. Real quickly, I want to ask you, Mike Espy, the Secretary of Agriculture, is coming out here. He says, you know, we may never find the cause of this contaminant, but we'll fix the problem. Believe him or not.
I can tell you what the cause of the problem is. If there was animal feces found in those hamburgers, and that came from the slaughtering floor, there's the cause of the problem.
So do you believe that the USDA is going to fix that?
Not on their past track record, no.
All right, when we come back, we're going to talk with a state meat inspector who says that while the state is doing the best job it can to deal with contaminated meat, it simply is not enough. And we'll continue. Don't go away. Stay with us. Tom Meaty, we're talking about the E. coli breakout and meat contamination here on Tom Meaty tonight. Go ahead.
Yeah, Steve, after what you've told us, I would like to know, do you eat hamburger?
Yes, I do, because my alternative is poultry, and that's even worse. So,
okay.
You know, there's this nervous laughter, and I realize that we're not laughing because it's funny, but we're laughing because there may not be any other avenue for us to use right now. But what is it about poultry that scares you, Steve?
This is streamlined inspection has been in poultry since the early 80s. And they have, the line speeds are running much faster, and a lot of the inspectors they use aren't full-time inspectors or intermittent employees. And
I want to go back. You talk about that line inspection being even faster. That one of the things you said may have gone by us rather quickly, and that is that as a meat inspector, you have 6 seconds, did you say?
Yeah.
As this meat carcass comes rolling. Now, we're talking, what, a 600-pound, 300-pound side of beef, whatever?
Yeah.
Rolling by you, and give me what you have to accomplish in that 6 seconds.
We have to adjust.
Stand up for me, if you will.
Okay.
I want to see this. The meat's, I'm serious, the meat's coming by. Do you get to stop it or what?
It's going by. We have to follow it on the line.
All right.
It's being pushed. The line's running at 41 feet per minute. We have to adjust the carcass, palpate the internal inguinal lymph node, palpate the kidney, look behind the kidney for any abscesses or any pathology or any contamination, palpate the diaphragm, look at the carcass for contamination.
And is the line moving the whole time you're doing this?
The line's moving the whole time.
So you're going along doing this,
yeah,
and then backing up to start with the next one.
Right, in an 8-foot space.
And you can't even describe what you have to do in 6 seconds, never mind accomplish it.
Right.
So I want to understand how many seconds would be a reasonable amount of time.
We'd have to have a time study on that, a serious time study that would take into account all the movements that we have to make. Personally, with in the fat cattle, you can look at fat cattle or you can look at old cows. The palpation process would be more important in the older cattle because they would be more apt to be diseased. The fat cattle are healthier animals disease-wise. We should be able to eliminate some of the palpations. We have during the past 6 years under streamlined inspection. We didn't do that. So we should take into account what's more important. My circuit supervisor came up to me the other day, and we were running dirty cattle, and he said, "You have people down there that aren't palpating the meat." I said, "Doc, what's more important, getting the contaminants off or palpating this healthy meat?" Because generally, if there's a pathological problem, you'd be more apt to detect it visually. And he was worried about the palpation and the procedure and doing it by the book as far as the palpation goes, and not so concerned, I took it, with the dirty meat.
Let me introduce Bert Bartleson, who is with the State Health Department Food Protection Office. What do you do?
I'm the technical expert for the state food program. So I work with local health departments to make sure that they're adequately trained And I also investigate foodborne disease outbreaks when they occur, when they're large or unusual, like this one is.
All right, but give me the nuts and bolts. Bert goes out. What does Bert do in the course of a day?
Talks on the telephone a lot. Teaches courses. Works with the laboratory and with the epidemiologists. Sometimes goes out in the field once in a while and actually looks at what's happening in.
So it's your part of your responsibility to make sure that the meat is cooked at the right temperature and for the right period of time and under the right conditions.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Are we doing it?
I think that we're doing a pretty good job in the state of Washington of protecting people's health, but you have to realize there are 30,000 licensed food establishments in this state, and there's a tremendous amount of turnover in the industry. We're talking about an industry in fast food where you may have two or three different people that hold the same job in the same year.
People have a very, and I know this is an understatement, heightened sense of awareness right now in respect to the hamburger that we buy and the hamburger that we eat. Are we being too paranoid, or are we not being paranoid enough?
Well, I think it's always sad when you have to get to the point of killing people before people care. But the reality of the situation is that we have 50 to 60 outbreaks of foodborne disease that we know about that are large enough to count. Each year we have additional thousands of people who get sick, and that's probably 1/10 or 1/20 of, or maybe even 1/100 of what's really out there. So we sort of see the tip of the iceberg.
What's your opinion of the USDA? Not Steve, but the USDA and its practices and the manner in which it does business.
Well, I think that they're doing things in the same way that they did them 25 years ago. And I think they need to view the current problem as a wake-up call to go ahead and get with the program and do something that'll protect these people.
How many people have to die before we start doing something or even get sick? Yep.
Who are you talking to?
Well, I'll direct that to Steve. How does the USDA respond? Besides Mike Espy traveling out here in a public relations effort, from Washington, D.C., what can we hope to see accomplished through all of this?
So far, and it's been lip service. They'll come on there and just give lip service to the thing. They'll say, yeah, we're going to do something about it, and then come up with some deregulatory program. I would like to see that, and I want to see that, and I will work to see that changed to a more positive aspect and maybe get something done.
Let's get down to the nut of this. Do you think the USDA has public health as its foremost consideration?
Me, personally?
Yeah.
I would say, right now, no.
What do you think, Steve?
Absolutely not.
So what if they're not concerned with public health, what is their reason for existence? What are they in the meat industry's pocket, or what?
I'll answer that one. The USDA, Food Safety and Inspection Service, the meat inspector, should not be a part of the USDA. The USDA was formed to promote agricultural products. We need, if we're going to get something done in this and get something accomplished, we need to have the Food Safety and Inspection Service moved from out of that agency and into the Food and Drug Administration. And then, we need to train inspectors in bacteriology so we know where these bacteria live, what kind of bacteria live on the kill floor and in the slaughterhouses, how we can get rid of them, and then we need the authority to do something about it.
A two-part question for Steve. Today, Jack in the Box announced that they would pay medical coverage for people who ate at their restaurant. Why can't we put some of the financial burden on the slaughterhouses? And two, since Mr. Espy is going to be in town, why don't we have him talk to some of the families affected instead of the people in Olympia trying to cover their tail ends?
There's two pretty good ideas right there.
Yes, the meat that comes from this into the slaughterhouses, only a small percentage of those cows are infected with O157H7. They should be also working upstream to find out which farms the actual infected with this particular strain of E. coli exist. So those farms should go under greater inspection also. This should be working upstream, not just stopping with the slaughterhouse, not just blaming all inspection or...
But see, let me make this clear. The USDA does not inspect for E. coli bacteria.
I understand that. And that's why a combination of USDA and FDA should work this upstream onto the farms and find out where it's coming from.
Steve has
not just it's not just up to a 6-second inspector to protect our health.
All right, but the USDA, right or not, has apologetically said, look, testing for this bacteria is too time consuming. It's going to cost the meat industry too much money. We can't do it. Yes or no?
The prime concern of the Food Safety and Inspection Service seems to be the well-being of the meat industry instead of the well-being of the consumers. That's why we need to get moved.
All right, we have a caller on the line. I thank you for your patience. Go ahead, you're on town meeting.
Hi, I ate in Tacoma at the same Jack in the Box the same day and had the exact same meal as little boy Michael Noel that passed away. And my son was actually the one eating the equivalent of the Happy Meal, and I had cut his hamburger up, and it was raw in the middle. I noticed it, and I actually gave part of it to the dog. She's fine, but I threw the rest away. But I ate a hamburger myself, and I'm fine. I was 9 months pregnant. I've since delivered my baby, but I was real surprised that I wasn't affected, and my son's hamburger was completely raw. Also, I'm the director of a child care facility, and we deal with 14-2-year-olds that were diapering, and I'd like to know what we can do above and beyond latex gloves, etc., to prevent secondary infection, because that's how the other little two-year-old died.
Let's take one thing at a time. Let's first of all, is there any explanation for why this sudden eruptive outburst of E. coli has happened? I mean, assuming that the practices that you've described in the slaughterhouses has remained consistent over the years, why all of a sudden? Any explanation? Was this a particularly virulent strain of bacteria? Was it overly contaminated? What?
The only explanation that I would have for it would be that it's been something that's been waiting to happen, and that Jack in the Box got caught. They undercooked their hamburgers, and it really, I think they've been unfairly perhaps blamed in this, because I'm sure they were expecting clean beef from their suppliers.
Okay, when we come back, let's address that other woman's question. Also, it seems obvious that what we don't know can indeed hurt us. And what we've been hearing from Steve is that there's a lot we don't know. We'll talk about it more when we come back. Stay with us. Town meeting, we're talking about the E. coli breakout and meat contamination in general, and I want to introduce Dr. Mimi Fields here, who basically you're the Surgeon General for the state of Washington. How's that?
That's pretty close.
What is your assessment of all of this?
Well, my assessment is that obviously something has gone very wrong, and that's evident by the numbers of people who have become sick. We do see smaller numbers of outbreaks, and ultimately I think we have to look at two things. One, the specific of this particular event and trying to get as much help as we can in understanding what went wrong. And two, the system and what we might need to really reinforce that we have adequately public health protection.
Okay, let me ask you this. Back in it was several years ago. It was like 1989. There was an E. coli breakout in Walla Walla in Spokane.
86,
okay. Several people died.
Yes.
17 people died in a nursing home in Canada. E. coli breakout contamination in the meat that they ate. I mean, this is not new. This is something that we've known about. What do we need to do to get the USDA? Is it, as Steve suggests, getting them out of the picture and bringing the Food and Drug Administration in?
Well, that certainly may be a piece of it. I think it has to be acknowledged that Washington has been more aggressive and assertive. You know, our food standards are among the best and strictest in the nations. We're one of the few states that actually reports E. coli. And that's how we're able to get on top of this. I think here we are, one of the best states ever, and we are still having a problem, ought to be held up as a mirror to the USDA.
You've given me what we call a great segue, because over here we have Dr. John Kobayashi, who helped establish that aggressive tone for the state of Washington, and it is largely your efforts that have, you know, increased the regulatory efforts to try and deal with this. Are you caught unprepared and rather aghast at what's happened here then?
Well, we learned a lot of lessons out of the outbreak in Walla Walla in 1986. And in proportion to
how big Walla Walla is in comparison to the Puget Sound population. That was just as severe an outbreak with about 37 people ill and two people who died. And that was a big reason why we established E. coli O157 as a reportable disease. We heard about the Walla Walla outbreak 2 weeks after it had gotten started because the patients were being transferred to the Seattle area. Had something like that happened in this situation with the Jack in the Box outbreak, the results would have been disastrous, even more disastrous than they were.
Okay, thank you. We have a caller on the line. I thank you for your patience. Go ahead, you're on town meeting. Caller?
Hello?
Go ahead, please.
Yes, I would agree wholly with this meat inspector. I'm a former meat and poultry inspector myself. And I would say that this potential has been there, and it will be there unless those people in Congress who control this get a hold of the situation and take control over the USDA.
Let me ask you.
The problem would be the superiors. They will not back up the line inspector. The line inspector knows a lot about food safety, and he is there to do the job that he's hired to do. And there's a simple way to solve this is follow the Safe Meat Act.
Let me ask you a question. As a former meat inspector, do you hear what Steve is saying? And were you inhibited from doing the job that you were hired to do?
Absolutely. I quit under duress. I was assaulted, and I quit.
So this is
nothing. The superiors will not back up the line inspector. They would have occasional spot inspections from Washington, you know, from the head office. They would send these inspectors out, but every time the slaughter plants, the poultry plants, they would know this was coming. They would clean up.
They had advance warning.
Well, the area supervisor would look good. The regional would look good.
Everybody looked good, but the meat was still contaminated. Gotcha.
And USDA said they were helping the consumer.
Gotcha.
I have a question for Steve. In these slaughterhouses, how much are the slaughterhouses doing a self-inspection?
They have several programs. Right now, partial quality control, total quality control, improved processing inspection, performance-based inspection system. All these are programs in that set up statistics to make it look like there's an inspection going on. They're taking the inspector off the floor, putting him down on the floor to monitor plant tests, and it's a step toward deregulation. So they've been generally, over the past dozen years, moving toward self-inspection continuously.
I want to know why every time when something like this happens, it always goes back to big business and the government. I mean, I blame Jack in the Box. I blame the meat supplier. I blame the butcher. My son is not expendable because these people are interested in dollars and cents. I mean, what about health and safety for the consumer?
I want to point out that the little boy who's sleeping through all of this right now, he ate at Jack in the Box and went through the E. coli ordeal. How's he doing now?
He's doing fine. He got his first negative test back on Thursday, but he ate there the last time on the 7th, got sick on the 10th. And it's been since then that we've been watching him, you know, every day to make sure that he's getting him better and it's not attacking any, you know, the rest of his body and missing work and everything else, all because he ate a hamburger at Jack in the Box. Jack in the Box hasn't contacted us and even asked us if we'd like a refund on the hamburger we purchased, haven't asked us if he is indeed all right. All they're worried about is the lost business they might experience. So they're putting out commercials to the people who may not want to eat there because they've heard about this. They're not putting out commercials to those of us who have been affected.
See, this is, well, you know what you... She raises an excellent point. When you look at the trail here, what you get is Jack in the Box going, sorry. You hear Vons, who supplied the meat to Jack in the Box, going, well, we don't know how. You hear, you know, everyone offering excuses, including the USDA, as to why this happened, and no one offering any reasonable steps that can be taken, except for you, gentlemen.
Here's what needs to be done.
I'll tell you what, let me put you on hold. Let's get to what needs to be done. We will talk about that when we come back. Stay with us. Please don't go away.
town meeting. I want you to get to the caller who's been waiting. Go ahead. You're on town meeting.
Yes, I was just wanting to ask a question. It sounds like it's going to be a little while before who finds out who's responsible for what. Anyway, in the meantime, I was wondering if the gentleman that explained the kill procedures and so forth about the carcasses could maybe explain to us how the milk is...
if the milk is affected.
Well, right. If,
let's
if
not
it
make
is,
a
and,
leap of assumptive faith here.
Right, and also... If he can maybe get into the procedure a little bit about how they handle the milk part, end of this, and if there is a E. coli potential.
All right.
Or
any danger of the E. coli getting into the milk supply?
I'm going to feed that question to the
I'll take that
doctor.
Bert?
Absolutely, it can be a problem. We've had problems, particularly with raw milk. Pasteurization is effective at destroying E. coli 15787. So if you have properly pasteurized milk, you wouldn't get sick.
Okay, how about the cooking procedure? What if we microwave it? What if we cook this stuff till it's burned? Does that assure that this bacteria is no longer threatening?
Absolutely, no question about it. If you can get it to 158 degrees completely throughout that hamburger,
but
you're
you
not going to get
when
sick.
When I'm out in the backyard flipping the barbecue, I'll be darned if I've got a thermometer or a thermostat there to gauge the temperature. Is that what's going to be required of me?
No, I don't think so. I think what we can do, though, is we can cut that hamburger in the middle and we can see if there's any pink color there. If there's any pink color there, it's not that hot. So you really probably shouldn't be eating any
hamburger.
So
no more rare, no more medium rare hamburgers.
No, and I think there's the other thing is people are going to say, well, what about steaks? And that's a lot different because at least on a steak, the contamination's on the outside, and you're going to cook the outside fairly thoroughly.
So if you sear that, you're okay.
Much better.
I have two questions. One is, they had an outbreak in 86 in California with 300 ill and two died, and we never heard anything about it from tainted meat. And the other is, what about the genetic probe they're working on to test for E. coli?
I'm not aware of the 86 outbreak at all.
Okay, what about the genetic? There is someone, and I remember reading this very recently, that has developed a system, Steve, that really shortcuts the testing time for E. coli bacteria presence down to 24 hours.
I think I read about that in the paper today. He had that, said it had it almost perfected or something like that.
Would that be something?
We'll have to see how it goes.
I agree with you.
I don't know.
Yeah, we keep talking about it being 1986 and since then and everything. My sister died of it 14 years ago, and they thought it was caused by the flu then. And I was wondering how many outbreaks were there of the flu before 1986 when it became E. coli?
That's part of the problem. How many cases of food poisoning was there?
So it's just the diagnostic abilities that we have today. E. coli was not identified until 1982, correct?
E. coli 015787. I mean,
82.
E. coli's been around forever.
I think Jack in the Box and McDonald's and all the rest of these fast food places, wherever you eat, I think that's one way that can move faster than the federal government in ensuring that our meat supply, at least to those places, is safe. Our money talks. Don't go there anymore until they can guarantee that the stuff's safe. You know? They're the ones, they pay all sorts of money. They're cutting their costs down to 2 or 3 cents, and from what I understand, their costs can't be cut if you're having it inspected every 6 seconds. Make them push it up to 2 seconds.
Here's the thing, though. It's not just restaurants or fast food restaurants. It is supermarkets, and it is butchers, and it is every single place that you buy hamburger.
Let's starve them.
Here's what needs to be... If I can make a point real quickly, here's what needs to be done. We need to have a congressional investigation of the Food Safety and Inspection Service, an internal congressional investigation, internal government investigation. Leave industry out of it. They already have too much influence over the USDA. The Congressional Committee needs to hear the critics of the USDA, because I've been talking for 6 years, and I'm having a problem being heard by these people in Washington. Now we need to have the critics be heard by the Congress. We need to better train meat inspectors in bacteriology. And if we can take some concrete steps toward that, We'll be taking concrete steps toward a safer meat supply.
That is a great point to pick up on. When we come back, let's talk about what we might be able to do to get Congress off the dime, to get this whole process started, and is it going to be one of those laborious 5 years down the line, we're still not done studies yet, how do we speed this thing up? Because here's a man whose sister has died, there are parents whose children have died, there's still over a dozen kids in the hospital on kidney dialysis. This is something that has to be dealt with, and it can't be put off any longer. Stay with us, we'll be back. Welcome back to town meeting. Go ahead.
Individuals don't take the time, unless, of course, it affects a family member, to go and write letters to our congressman or speak up. And I say the way that all of us can speak up is every one of us boycott hamburger. You run that across the whole nation, and I said, we'll see what a change is going to come.
Go ahead, Bert. I don't think that that's going to solve the problem of food safety in America. I mean, we're talking hamburger today, but chicken is probably more contaminated than hamburger by and large.
Turkey.
Any meat product that comes from an animal, and it can be a fish. I mean, fish has all kinds of bacteria and parasites in it, too. I mean, any of those things, shellfish, they all have contamination. We have to learn, first of all, how to protect ourselves by cooking things adequately, and secondarily, how to prevent contamination as much as feasible and possible.
But should that entire burden, because what it seems right now is that the entire burden is on the consumer. Let me get to one of the callers. Go ahead, you're on town meeting.
Okay, I worked for Jack in the Box before, and I don't work for them anymore now. But now one question. They say no matter how high you cook that patty, the contamination would have been still there. And there seems to be there's no clear message here. The contamination wasn't going to stay there or by all cooking right. It?
Let's deal with this definitively. If you cook the beef patty, will it kill off the E. coli bacteria?
Absolutely. But the problem is, and there is a problem, Jack in the Box is using frozen hamburger patties. The frozen hamburger patties are not always flat. If they're bridged up or if they're curled up, they don't contact the grill, and that means that the heat is 1/20th as effective at cooking things. So you get undercooked hamburgers. We find an incredible amount of variation in hamburgers. They're a mixture of fat and meat and ice crystals, and you can find 30 to 40 degree temperature variation if you probe five different places in a hamburger. So you can have four of those five that are adequately cooked, and the fifth one is inadequately cooked, and if the contamination is in that spot, you're in big trouble.
Because everything else that then hits that spot is going to be contaminated.
Well, we've been getting a lot of calls at the local health departments about that they're just going to turn vegetarian. I've been hearing a lot tonight, too. And one of the things that we have to remember is that turning vegetarian doesn't protect you from foodborne illness alone either. I mean, you can get hepatitis A from salads. You can get salmonella from cantaloupes. You can get apple cider has been shown to have E. coli in it, the raw apple cider. And so we need to remember good hand washing techniques when we're handling any kinds of foods or after we go to the bathroom before we prepare our foods for our families. And, you know, it can happen in the home, it can happen at schools, it can happen in restaurants. So we need to remember and go back to the basic principles of just basic sanitation, good hand washing, and taking care of yourself, protecting yourself.
Okay. You have what? Bear with me here. This is you just stand over here. We'll get you. And this is a bottle of hydrogen peroxide.
Yeah. How many of you have it in your home? You probably all do. Have you heard that it's poison? Yeah. Okay. Why?
It doesn't help to talk to them without a mic. So bear with me here. What do you want to say about this?
What I want to say about this is that medical science today has not yet found a bacteria that this won't kill.
All right, let me pick it up from there. No. Do we wash it? Let me hold on. Do we wash our meat in this? Any good?
I don't think I would.
I'm not questioning
but
your...
I don't know that much about it either, so...
Hold on, bear with me, because I don't know if this is the answer
you
here.
You know what this is made of?
Hydrogen H2O. Peroxide. Water.
H2O2.
Gotcha, but what...
Water and oxygen.
I realize that, sir, but what I'm trying to get at is, you say we need to pressure Congress. You say we need to be more aware of where we eat and how we eat. We hear from the health inspectors who say we have to take personal responsibility for our own health habits. We've had at least one child who seems to have contracted this E. coli by not eating contaminated hamburger, so it's obvious. Mm-hmm. Two children. Okay, your daughter. So this is a nasty, virulent spread of disease, correct?
Absolutely. It doesn't take very many of these bacteria to make you deathly ill.
But, well, he says it's not the hamburger company's fault. You say, yes, it is.
I say, absolutely, it is.
Can we get to them, plain and simple? Can we?
I think we can, if we would all take action.
All right, let's get, because I do, I want to conclude here with some definitive form of action that we as individuals and collectively as a community can take. Let us deal with that when we come back. Let's deal with something specific. Stay with us. Caller on the line, thanks for waiting. Go ahead.
Yes, I'm concerned about repercussions for Steve's job here. Is he worried about it?
You know, he has. Are you worried about employment tomorrow, Steve?
Well, I think about it, but it's something I can't worry about, because this could have just as easily happened to my daughter. So you got to put your priorities in place. If it happens, it's supposed to happen.
I agree. I think a lot of it, though, is down to the bottom buck. All of us has hit on the fact that cleanliness is not being done. I think education needs to be done. I think the janitorial industries need to take more responsibility in what they do and what they provide. I think education from the state health department to the janitorial companies who are providing services. I think it's a lot of education. It's a lot of responsibility. And I think as business entrepreneurs, we need to take the responsibility in our own communities.
Caller on the line, go ahead. You're on town meeting.
In defense of the attempts of Jack in the Box, I do think that it should be noted that during the week, all week last week, because I was home with the flu, there were commercials every single hour by the president of the Jack in the Box, as well as full-page ads in a lot of the local papers. I think they should be commended for that. May not have been as timely as people wanted.
But doesn't it strike you that even as those ads were being aired and run in the newspapers, that they still found a Jack in the Box on Mercer Island that was still cooking the hamburgers? And I mean, I'm not, don't make no mistake here, I'm not trying to make Jack in the Box the fall guy here. The fall guy seems to be the USDA, because they are not acting in the public interest. Are they or are they not, Steve?
Not to date so far, in my opinion. No, they're not acting in the public
interest. I want to go back over. I want to come out of this with an idea of what we can do. What do you think the best efforts should be given to us right now?
Write or call your congressman and tell him you want action. Government works like this. If they don't hear nothing from you, they assume everything's all right. But if you're calling them or writing them and yelling in their ear and saying, hey, we got a problem, then they're going to set up and take notice. And I think a figure was given to me one time. I think your congressmen go by some kind of agenda. They assume one consumer call speaks for roughly 4,000 people or so in their area.
So we need to get a lot of people to contact their congressmen.
Sure. I mean,
Bert, what would you think? What are the steps that you think are most important to be taken at this point?
Well, I think that one of the things that we have to do is to realize that foodborne disease is not just a tummy ache. It's not just a minor illness that you get over. It can kill you. And the CDC estimates that, you know, 9,000 people or more in America die from foodborne disease every year. And that's a huge number. And the thing that's so sad about it is that it's almost entirely preventable.
All right. Please join me in thanking Steve Cockrum and Bert Bartelson for their insight, and very much appreciate. I want to say our hearts go out to those families whose children have died, and to those families whose children are still in the hospital and have been sick. God bless you. We hope everything works out okay for you. I want to remind you that coming up next week on town meeting, hidden camera reports have become a hot new trend in journalism and have become a great deal of controversy. Steve's report several months ago on ABC dealt with carcasses that were hidden camera filmed falling into feces. There is no reporter who is more less of a stranger than to these undercover reports than Geraldo Rivera. He's going to be our special guest next week when we explore to what lengths it is acceptable for a reporter to go to get the story. It is going to be an interesting and timely town meeting. Be sure to tune in next Sunday at 6 o'clock. Thank you very much for having watched tonight. We ask you to take care. Please have a good week.
Can you predict your own future with the palm of your hand? On Northwest Afternoon tomorrow at 3, fortune teller Max Maven will teach you how to tap into your psychic self.